so grateful for the opportunity to express my congratulations to the class of 2018. I've watched all of these friends grow up, go through 13 years of school, and it's just so sweet to see everybody at this amazing moment in their lives. I'm very proud of all of you, and I'm especially grateful for the opportunity to introduce one student who exemplifies all the best qualities of the class of 2018. Whether he's impeccably finishing his homework, writing and performing his original music, or simply showing the love of God in his everyday life, this student does everything he comes across with diligence, honor, and dedication. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming my friend and your class of 2018 valedictorian, Drew Greenway.
Well, first of all, I would like to thank the Chester County School Board for furnishing a microphone that I can't drop this time. If you were at the academic banquet, thank you so much. I appreciate that. So, greetings, class of 2018, faculty and staff of Chester County High School, friends, family, loved ones, and the occasional wayfarer who saw the ad in the paper or the lights from the road and, you know, somehow managed to stumble into the auditorium, of course. Tonight, we celebrate the commencement of the 104th graduating class of Chester County High School, from graduands to graduates. As dictated by the unspoken finality of tradition, my cumulative grade point average renders me eligible for the title of valedictorian, and thus the honor or punishment, really depending on how one views the matter, of delivering a commencement address to my fellow graduates, offering pastoral wisdom as the keys of success, typically urging to think outside the box or recall the highly overstated, the sky is the limit when you believe in yourself. Well, these are often accompanied by a series of anecdotes, or at least three quotes, of which one is of absolute necessity to be from Albert Einstein, a former U.S. president, an American television icon, or children's author, all culminating to form a 5 to 10 minute massive lexicon graphical art that the majority of the audience will either tune out after the first 30 seconds, or fail to remember the following day. Now, although I by no means possess the intellectual or creative capacity of my predecessor, who spoke in the life of legacy of Bob Ross this time last year, I do mean to honor the occasion with socks, emblazoned with the likeness of the world's greatest advocate of the happiness of trees. More out of coincidence than reverence, today being Monday and this Bob Ross sock day on my clothing schedule rotation, but I digress. Graduates, this room, from the 2B graduates on stage, to the school board members in the audience, to the business professionals, lawyers, doctors, engineers, postal workers, teachers, construction workers, farmers, plumbers, electricians, to those who actually think that Aquaman is a valid superhero, that Marvel can even come close to attaining the absolute divine glory of DC, or that Disney gives George Lucas's 40-year-old brainchild the near-religious reverence that it really deserves. To everyone, regardless of socioeconomic background, religious affiliation, or placement on the political spectrum, there is but one quality that has persisted as an indiscriminate absolute in the human condition. It is one so profound that to ignore it would be an unmitigated scientific impossibility. If anything is to be gleaned from the arbitrary gallimaufry of words uttered here tonight, let it be this. This room, our world, myself especially, is filled with failure. Now, before you ready your tomatoes or pay tribute to George W. Bush by hurling shoes at me, I entreat you to consider the previous statement. Our world is built upon the guaranteed occurrence of failure. In fact, it thrives on it. Healthcare is founded upon the inevitability that one's overall wellness will decline, or that one's immune system will fail to keep the body in a state of perfect vitality. The cellular phone that you refuse to allow more than 10 feet from your body at any given point in time, and possibly even the one you're using at this very moment, in hopes the short white kid with the womanly voice on stage will stop talking soon, is more than likely a different model than you owned this time 5 years ago, which only proves that smartphone companies depend on the failure of their products to satisfy the consumer's long-term interest. Restaurants are incredibly successful for the sole reason that people increasingly fail to prepare their own meals. In every sense of the phrase, failure drives the progress and betterment of humanity, for without it, computers would still occupy entire warehouses just to calculate the simplest of mathematical algorithms. Sheep blood would still be the go-to medium for transfusions, and 40 million leeches would still be imported annually for curing your purpose of the sniffles. And given that the majority of you in the audience are most likely not affected with hemochromatosis or polyphasemia vera, the very notion of blood removal is inconceivable to valid medical practice. Fairly well, George Washington. On a more individualized level, the rate of success versus failure can generally be reduced to a constant ratio, with increased victory often being born of equally increased defeat. And this has especially been the case for my personal life. Standing here rewarded with the opportunity of addressing my fellow soon-to-be graduates based on my achievement in the realm of academia, I can admit to having experienced a world of failure over the course of my high school experience. From failing a college sociology exam by one question, realizing, after the fact that I'd finished my solar panel, that I had wired it completely backwards, unabashedly walking into lunch sophomore year and announcing my amazement that Ozzy Osbourne so strikingly and coincidentally resembled the lead singer of Black Sabbath, to unintentionally yet erroneously altering the entire seating arrangements of last year's baccalaureate service, and thus being a large contributing factor as to the lack of designated seating this year. You're very welcome, graduates, for that. As a piece of advice born from my personal endeavors outside the classroom, this is highly important, silicone caulking is made largely out of acetic acid, so if you raise the caulk gun to your nose to discover where the smell of vinegar is being emanated, you will most likely wake up 30 minutes later being questioned by your parents as to why you were lying on the floor holding a caulk gun, so consider yourself warned. In all earnesty, fellow graduates, I encourage you to prepare yourself to meet failure head-on when it finds you, for it is not a question of if, but when you encounter calamity. For even now, sitting on this elevated wooden construction, peering into an audience of hundreds in attendance, for the sole purpose of honoring your progression into adulthood, if you have not already experienced a cataclysm in your personal life, then I would request that you buckle up your metaphorical seatbelt and brace your impact. You may feel the missing pieces of your life are finally beginning to come together, that the world is your oyster and that you are the pearl, as they say. You may even have confidence that you have found the person you intend on marrying, or that you are about to land your next big break in the career world. Now granted, these are monumental reasons for celebration and bouts of euphoria, but if you are not prepared for the day when your life may seem not quite as peachy, then it can absolutely and completely destroy you, driving you down a cyclone of self-doubt and uncertainty, taking your life, throwing it into a blender, and slowly eating away with the tortilla chips until you find yourself at the abyss of humanity, with nowhere to look but up, trapped in the regret of having become someone who is as an immeasurable distance from who you had planned to be. For most, this is an all too familiar state of being, and failure is accepted and welcomed with open arms. For others, the decimation of selves comes unexpectedly as to wreak havoc upon one's sense of identity. Now, regardless of the onset of failure, the arrival of disappointment can be one of the greatest things to happen in your life, but only if you refuse to accept it as your permanent reality. Recalling elementary physics and homegrown redneck engineering, a spring approached its maximum potential energy the more force that is crushed down upon it, triggering an explosion of kinetic energy upon release, taking flight and landing on the teacher's desk in the case of every time I took an ink pen apart in class. In the same way, your failure can serve as your launch pad into reaching your greatest potential for success, but only if you allow it. I could stand before you tonight and lie to you and tell you that there is a formula by which to attain instant mastery over any area of your life. I could suggest creating a clothing schedule to eliminate the need for wasting time on decisions that lack lots of logical consequences. I could recommend consuming a cup of more blended bitter greens every night to promote fiber intake or warn you of the dangers of taking in more than a fist-sized amount of red meat in a week. I could quote Einstein's assertion that the day that you stop learning is the day that you start dying and flash statistics collected by those with more letters behind their name that are in the speech that show a correlation between the choice to retire and the onset of cognitive decline, regardless of age. I could suggest any number of things to you, but the truth of the matter is that you've most likely seen enough ads on the internet or claims to instant success on social media to last you a lifetime. And I apologize when I tell you this, but they are nothing more than mere suggestions. As one of the wisest men in my life once told me, in regards to my relationship with Christ and of life in general, there is no 15-step plan to better yourself as a person, and there is no formula to success. There is absolutely nothing for the sole purpose that anything with remotely concrete and rigid structure would not leave room for mistakes. Life, graduates, does not occur when everything goes in your favor, with you meeting success after success, never falling short of the mark set before you. Rather, your existence is transformed into a life more fulfilled when you are exposed, when you are tried, sent through the fire, and forced to confront your mistakes and all the lives that they have affected, whether insignificant or profound. I say again, graduates, the only limits to your potential are the ones that you set for yourself. Mediocrity accepts what is given while breaks pre-existing boundaries while incessantly holding curiosity in the likeness of a battering ram. I'm very certain that 90% of the audience is either zoned out at this point or two-thirds of the way through the fabled La La Land fabricated by kindergarten teachers around the globe, so I will say it once more. Graduates, your soul pines for flight, yet your head remains earthward bound. Will you not put aside the lies you've been told your entire life to stop striving when you have attained what is merely good enough? Will you not push aside your fear of failure and take the leap of the cliff from opportunity? opportunity before you, for better or for worse? Will you not rouse your potential from its long overdue slumber and set it free on the winds of what you know you can achieve? Stop saying that the sky is the limit, when there is there's an infinity of a firmament beyond our atmosphere. The phrase is overused anyway. You may feel like a tiny, momentary speck within an indifferent universe, as coined by Marvel's Stephen Strange, but as long as the indifference fails to reside within you, there's nothing obstructing the way for you to become a force impossible to ignore. It's my hope that each and every one of the 206 individuals making the transition into adulthood tonight will return to the world with a renewed vigor and sense of purpose to strive for a life of service for the betterment of the community, for themselves, and for their God. And as Dylan Thomas famously states in one of my favorite pieces of poetry, "Graduates, do not go gentle into that good night." Thank you.